woven together. We culminate that in a visit that we have today, and we are especially blessed and grateful for Dr. Harrison for arranging for her father-in-law, Lila's and Izzy's grandfather, to be with us today, her grandparents, and Lila's going to introduce them in a moment. But what I want to say before we get started is the reason why we do this every year at Notre Dame. And the reason is because at some point in time, our Holocaust survivors will not be here. And you have a special responsibility because you've studied the history, you've grappled with the questions, you have that responsibility to be the voice for the future, and to remember the stories that you've learned in class, and to remember the stories that you'll hear today, and to be able to say, yes, I understand what happened, and I am now a witness to what these people were a witness to. Okay, so it's a special responsibility. We take it seriously. It's one of those serious moments at Notre Dame. And so now I'd like to introduce Lila, who will introduce her grandparents.
My fellow Wolves, if you don't know me, I'm Lila Ullmann. I feel very fortunate to be here today introducing two very important people in my life, Ilsa and Gunter Ullmann, or my Omi and Opie. Gunter was born in Mannheim, Germany in 1922, and Ilsa was born in Vienna, Austria in 1927. As we've already studied in our history, English, and religion classes, being Jewish in both of these communities was very dangerous as Hitler was rising to power. Both of their families were very smart about their next move. As their rights and freedoms were becoming more and more limited, they decided to take the huge step and move to Shanghai, China. This allowed my grandparents to escape the deathly claws of the European ghettos and concentration camps, but they definitely didn't escape the harsh life of being Jewish during that time. Now, I don't want to spoil the whole story for you, so I'll tell you a little bit about what my Omi and Opie are up to now. They've lived in San Francisco since 1949. My grandpa, who's just about as in love with his city as he is with his wife, volunteers at the San Francisco Visitor Information Center. And over spring break, I was actually really lucky to be able to go to work with him one day. And I just saw his face light up every time he like booked a bus tour or recommended an attraction. And my grandma volunteers at the Laguna Honda Hospital, where she chats with her coworkers just about as much as she works. I love visiting my Omi and Opie on the weekends, eating my Omi's endlessly delicious meals, talking with them about anything from politics to say yes to the dress, and just reveling in their company. So please help me, as I welcome my grandparents, Ilsa and Gunter Ullmann, to talk about, and Gunter will talk about first his life in Germany, and then in Shanghai, and Ilsa will chime in as she pleases.
Thank you, Lila, for the wonderful introduction. Lila is part of the happy ending to my story. I'm very humble. I've never talked to so many people before, and I hope I'll deserve to have that talk to you today. You guys are all lucky to go to high school, you probably have graduated pretty soon, go to college, and have a whole life ahead of you with lots of prospects. Well, when I was your age, that's a different story. I was born in 1922, in Mannheim, Germany, to a German couple, and grew up in Germany. My parents were very proud Germans. They were very patriotic. They tried to do everything they country. My father fought in World War I. He was, as a German soldier, he was decorated with the Iron Cross, which is one of the highest honors available. And his certificate that came with the Iron Cross said, amongst other things, that the gratitude of your country will be for you forever. Well, it never happened that way. So Germany lost the war, and our Kaiser fled the country, and from a monarchy we became a republic with a democratically elected government. The economy collapsed. Unemployment was tremendous high, inflation was rampant, and the government couldn't cope with the problems that we had because of the losing the war. Now there were two factions in Germany who tried to take advantage of it. One was the Communist Party, one was the Hitler and the Nazi Party. Communist Party used that as slogan that the proletariat will rule the world, and the scapegoat was capitalism. They had demonstrations, random demonstrations, carrying signs, very disorganized. Hitler's Nazi Party was very organized. They all wore uniforms. They all marched in two-step in formation, and they proclaimed the glory, to return to the glory of the German government, of the German people. And they needed a scapegoat also. And their scapegoat were the German Jews. And we were German Jews. We didn't really believe what they said, and nobody believed, but this constant propaganda people began to believe what Hitler and his Nazi hordes had to say. And then in 1933, he was duly elected, democratically elected, and the moment he took power, he dissolved parliament and he ruled by decree. And their first project was to get rid of the Jews. We didn't know yet how they will do it, but they had a plan. For one thing, they declared the German that they were not Jews, were the master race, the Aryan master race of the world, and everybody else was beneath them. And they did everything to denigrate people who didn't belong to the German, not Aryan race. And shortly after they took power, they started to boycott Jewish stores. They painted big Jews on the windows. They posted the guards in front of the stores, and the stores had no choice but to turn over their businesses to the Nazis. In 1934, after 6 years of school, I went to start a new semester in school. I walked into my class, and there were five other Jewish students in there, and we were called out and said, "You can't come in anymore," and that ended my education, my formal education, 6 years after I started school. Now the Jewish community in Germany, in Mannheim, they formed some classes and used the teachers and professors, Jewish teachers and professors that were expelled from the schools to teach us, but it didn't last very long. And after those classes closed, they started another class for people to learn a trade. He's a carpenter or locksmith. I joined the locksmith class, and I worked there for a few years. the situation got worse and worse and worse. We got depressed more and more and more. And we heard rumors of concentration camps being opened, but we were not sure about that. But then on June the 17th, 1938, my father always prepared breakfast for us. While he was preparing breakfast, the doorbell rang, two Nazis stood in front of the door, and they wanted to see my father. My father came out to talk to them, and he came back to us and said, "I have to go." They gave him the chance to get dressed, and then took him away. For 2 weeks, we had no idea where he was. Then after about 2 weeks, we got a form letter from Dachau concentration camp that he was there and he's doing fine. He was pretty tired. So my mother, she tried to get information. She tried to talk to people we knew that were not Jewish, and they tried to make arrangements. And my father was gone for 2 months, and after 2 months, my mother got a telephone call, "Your husband is coming home tonight." So I'll never forget that moment. We were sitting in the bedroom, my mother on one side, my brother and I on the other, and the door opened, my father came out, and I never forget what I saw. He was bald-headed, his head was full of blisters and burns, his eyelids were shut, swollen shut, and his cheeks were burnt, his ears were burnt, his hands were swollen, and he had passed across a lot of weight, and his clothes just hung on his body. And he just stood there, and tears were running down his cheek. And I never forget that moment. That's what people can do to people. It's unbelievable. So my mother nursed him back to health, that's what my people. He tried to leave Germany. We tried to go to the United States. The American government had a quota for German people. They only let in so many a year. Our number was so high that it would have taken years for us to go to the United States. And my father, he went from consulate to consulate, North America, South America, all over the world, but nobody would take any Jews. And so we just sat there and tried and tried and tried, and nothing happened. Then towards the end of October, a French Jew in Paris killed an employee of the German embassy in Paris. The Nazis took that opportunity to build up a frenzy of hatred for the Jews. The Jews have declared war on Germany, and blah, blah, blah. And on November the 9th, it started with the day of the broken glass. We didn't know yet what happened, but on November the 10th, my father got a call about 5 o'clock in the morning, told him to leave the house. My father left the house, and while he was taking the elevator downstairs, a bunch of Nazis came up the stairs. Apparently they got lost or confused, and they asked our neighbor if there are any Jews in this house. Our neighbor, who hated the Nazis just as we did, said there's no Jews in the house. So we were safe from that part. But my father left, and we didn't know yet what was going on, so I went to my shop, to my training, and when I got there, they told us get out as quick as you can. As I left the building, there are two trucks with Nazi uniforms drove up and said, "Is that the Jewish school?" I didn't answer, and I took my bicycle and I started to go home. And on the way home, already I noticed that there were broken windows and things were thrown out of the buildings. And I came home, and my father came home at the same time, and my mother took us, and we just took off and walked the streets. And there were piles of furniture and books and clothing that were burning, and people cheered, and there were trucks with loudspeakers who told us, "Hit the street, kill the Jews, kill the Jews." And most people cheered. Some people just stood there and shook their heads. And it lasted till about 6 o'clock at night, and then the loudspeakers proclaimed that the so-called spontaneous protestation is over. So we went home, and we met with my father at home. And what my father did, he went to the bank, took out some money as much as he could, because they closed all the Jewish accounts, went to the travel agent and said, "Is there anywhere in the world where we can go that does not need any papers?" And he was told that it was Shanghai, China. And so he bought four passages on an Italian steamer to take us to Shanghai, China. We got ready to leave. We went to Berlin to say goodbye to our family there in Berlin. We pleaded with them to come with us, but they said they don't believe that all is that bad, and they all disappeared. On the day after Christmas, we left for Germany. We left from Germany. And we took the train, and at the German-Italian border, as we crossed the border, we felt like three people again. However, the conductor of the Italian train said we had the wrong tickets, and so we had all the little money that we could take with us, we had to spend to pay for the rest of the fare. As we came to Genoa to board the ship, we found out that the ship was 2 days late. And we were in Genoa without a penny, and we were practically homeless. And so my father went to the Jewish community in Genoa, and he got a voucher for a hotel for 2 nights. And after 2 nights, we finally boarded the ship, and we felt like kings, because everything was paid for, so we had our meals, we had our beds, and we took a 6-week journey from Genoa through the Suez Canal, down the African east coast, across the Dover to Yemen, to Sri Lanka, to India, to Singapore, to the other side of India, to the Philippines, to Hong Kong, and finally to Shanghai. As we got into Shanghai, Shanghai is a big city, and it's located about 20 miles inside the Wangpu River, which is a tributary to the Yangtze. And as we drove up the Wangpu River, we noticed on both sides utter destruction. The buildings were destroyed. Nothing was there. And we drove up and we came to Shanghai, and we docked, and we took a tender to the custom house at the entrance to Shanghai, and then we get out on the road, which is all the bound, and we were loaded on trucks, which were furnished again by the Jewish community in Shanghai, and we were trucked to a camp where we stayed for a few weeks. Shanghai was at that time was divided into a French section, a German, a British section, and a Japanese section. And the Chinese, the rest of the city belonged to the Chinese. We lived in that camp for a few weeks. My father, we had relatives in America who sent us a little money, which we used to get out of the camp. And we went through, rented a room at a Japanese doctor's who had a little hospital there. We rented a room and we spent the first night there, and we woke up in the middle of the night and we were covered with bed bugs. So my mother tried the best she could to get rid of the bed bugs, and we stayed there for about a month. And in the meantime, my brother and I, we were interviewed by some influential Jewish people, and since we didn't speak English or Chinese at that time, I was sent to a British automobile dealership as an apprentice, automobile mechanic apprentice. My brother was sent to a Korean machine shop. So we both started to work, and we made a little money. My father died, he was 52 years old at that time. I started all over again with a little, we did a little trading here and there, and we got enough money together. We bought a nice, we rented a nice apartment in a British section in a guarded colony, and we started to build our life slowly. I worked for the British company, first as an apprentice, and I worked my way up and became one of the junior managers, and we practically had built up a very half-decent life. Of course, we never wanted to stay there. And the British, they felt themselves superior about the rest of the people, and they disdained white people doing menial work. So they looked down on us, but it didn't bother us because we were ready to build up our own life. Then came Pearl Harbor Day. Pearl Harbor Day, it was a Monday morning. My dealership was in the French part, and we lived in the British part. When we went from the British part to the French part, there were British soldiers on one side of the border and French soldiers on the other side of the border. But on that Monday morning, the British were gone and there were Japanese guards. French guards, they didn't touch the French guards, because the French had made peace with Germany at that time. And as I went to my dealership, there was a big to-do, and the Japanese took over the dealership. They interned all the British, and they took over the whole building, including the people who worked there, including me. So I started to work for the Japanese as a mechanic, and then a little later they made a proclamation that all German Jews and Austrian Jews have to leave the settlement and all concentrate in a certain part of the Chinese section, which they call the Jewish ghetto. And my father found a room in one of those little houses, and he moved there. It was one room and a partition, a wooden partition. One side with my parents slept, the other side my father and I slept. We had no kitchen, there were no toilets. We had to, in Shanghai, you used pots, and you put the pots out every night in some coolies with carts came by, dumped the pots into the cart and took off. And that's how we lived for the till the end of the war. We were not provided with anything, we just had to live there. We still had to go to work to make a living, and it was a very tough time, and we had very little to eat, and very primitive conditions. My mother had to cook on a little, it was a tin can, which we converted into a stove, and we had to use charcoal, which was very smoky, and she stood there with her fan trying to fan the smoke, and we lived on rice mostly. I did not get paid by the Japanese. They gave you a sack of rice every month, about 10 pounds or so, which lasted us for the rest of the month. And we eventually had a few peas to put in there, or an egg to put in there, but that's how we lived. My father also continued working at the Korean machine shop, so we managed. And then we had to get passes to get out of the ghetto, and I had no problem because I worked for a Japanese company, but many people were not allowed to leave the camp. So comes the day when the Japanese surrendered. The Japanese surrendered, and again one morning we go out to work, and there were no Japanese. All the Japanese soldiers had disappeared. I went to my place of work, and there were a lot of confusion. And then the Americans came in, the GIs, and they took over the whole area, and they took over the dealership. So I worked for the Japanese. I worked for the British, the Chinese, the Japanese, and the Americans. And then life became pretty good for us, but we still lived in that little house, the room in the ghetto. And we tried, so my father went to the American consulate, and we found out that our quota number is good now, and we can apply for coming to the United States. So we applied for the United States, we got our visa. Except my mother. My mother, her eyes were all infected from all the smoke that she had, and they claimed that she had a contagious disease that she wouldn't give her a visa. So she had to see a doctor, and for 2 years, we were stuck in Shanghai, waiting for my mother to be well enough so she could get me. And so it was Christmas 1937 that we got the visa for all of us. And again, the Jewish community, together with UNRWA, United Nations Relief Organization, they chartered Army Transport, American Army Transport, and on the day before New Year's, we left the United States. There was one good thing that happened while I was in the ghetto. There were some organizations, youth organizations, which I joined. And my kids joined the same organization, and we got enough. got to know each other and became friends and eventually became lovers.
He went from company to company
and tell them, let me work for you for nothing to prove to you that I can do the job. And finally, somebody to remember that. And he worked there till about he was 70 years old. So he rented apartment in Leavenworth Street. And in the meantime, Ilse and I started to correspond. We wrote these letters to each other. And we fell all over and up again. And there was an offer to, but we could never know. There was an opportunity because her parents couldn't come to the United States, but they got a chance to go to Bolivia. Bolivia wouldn't let any Jews in, but there was a Catholic priest in Shanghai who for a few dollars would issue baptism certificates to people. And they got the baptism certificates and they that they got a visa to come to Bolivia, but they had to come to the United States to get to Bolivia. So there was our chance. I picked up Ilse and her parents from the pier a year later, before 1949, and we got to talking and we decided to go. Get married. In the meantime, I contacted an attorney who specializes in immigration. He arranged for Ilse to get a stay of deportation so that she doesn't have to leave the country. We got married, and 1 year later, 1950, she got her visa to come to the United States. So we both had to leave the United States. And she went to an American consulate in Vancouver, Canada, and then we could enter the United States legally. And from then on, it went up all the way. We both saved money, we made investments. I worked for, I became a manager at my dealership. Ilse worked at the telephone company, and we saved our money, and we decided to have children. When you hear hatred versus it, fight against it, because if you don't, hate will take over. And that's my story.
Anyway, he came from a very well-to-do family, and they, from being very, very well-to-do, they had to experience Hitler, and then from then on, very hard life. Okay, and then until we worked ourselves out again. Okay, so that's what I want to say.
Any questions? Oh yeah, that's another story.
Repeat the question.
In Germany, I met a girl who lived on the same floor as us. She was not Jewish, and we were very charming together. She came to our house to play. I went to her house to play. She came to five nights together, including my brother. And we were very close. And then one day I came to their house, and her father took me aside and said, "Gunter, it is better if you don't see each other again, because we would both get in trouble, because the Nazis issued laws that made it a crime for Jews to mix with non-Jewish Germans. So we both didn't. We both never talked to each other. We didn't know each other when we met, and so I thought that was the end of it. And about 6 years ago, the Red Cross contacted my brother. They found his telephone number and asked him if we are willing to be contacted by somebody. And the one who tried to contact us was the girl, Elfriede was her name. And we started to correspond and talk on the phone. And about 3 years ago, we decided to meet. And what?
2 years ago.
Two?
Yeah.
2 years ago. It's corrected. Under the auspices of the Red Cross, and we went to Germany, to a small town called Swedish Hall, and we were put up in a hotel, and we arranged to get together with Elfriede.
This one.
And we were treated royally, and we had made an arrangement the Red Cross arranged for us to get together. It was videoed, and Elfriede, she was 91, like me, and we met and we embraced, and we spent 10 glorious days together, reminiscing, and we met her whole family, and we left over 10 days, and we are still in touch, and we talk on the phone, and we are glad that that happened. And the Germans that we met in Germany at that time wondered if we can forget or give what has been done to us, we forgive, but we cannot forget. But that, so that is that end of the story.
About the story also is that Mr. Ullmann mentioned the man who said there are no Jews in our building. Well, that was Elfrieda's father. So the connection was very important that they, in a small way, saved my family. So having that reconnection by the Red Cross was all over it because they saw this amazing people story of, you know, the Jew and the Gentile reconnecting after so many decades after the war, when really they had nothing to hate anymore, and so they could be very happy to meet again. So it was a really lovely little people story.
Thank you. Thank you. In Jerusalem, in Israel, there is a Yad Vashem, which is a Holocaust memorial. And inside the Holocaust memorial, there is a garden. And in the garden, they commemorate non-Jews that helped Jews during the terrible times that happened. They were Chinese, they were Japanese, they were Germans, they were Catholics, all kinds of people who really helped the Jews when the things were going down. And they are being honored by Israel. Well?
But the thing is that I was young, 5 years younger, and I don't remember as much, especially not days. And well, our only way to get away from Vienna was Shanghai also. And we escaped and part of our family, but we left also some relatives which never got out of there. And we had a business which we had to close. Kristallnacht was the night when we had to get out of our apartment and put just take out whatever we could carry out quick, otherwise we lost it all. We had to move in with our other people in the same building, and we had to start our life over again in Vienna until we left for Shanghai. And then the story about us in Shanghai was pretty similar, I think. I don't think there was much more. Other store? In Shanghai? Yeah, we had a business in Shanghai also. And we had to move also in the designated area, and had to start all over again in Shanghai twice even. And then my parents had to go to Bolivia because they couldn't stay. And luckily, I just turned 22 when they left. And I was never without my parents. And it was very, very tough for me to leave them. We always lived together, we stayed together, and they left very far away. And I never knew whether I would see them again. But luckily, they brought him back to the United States. And unless you have any questions. I don't remember dates. I don't have that memory. I'm sorry. But he has all the memories of dates and everything. What he did. And if you have any questions, I'm very welcome.
The Shanghai community, in case it's not something that you studied, my guess is it probably isn't. There were 40,000 German and Austrian Jews who went to Shanghai. I think it was 36,000 or so, Jeff can probably correct me, German, and about 4,000 Austrian, and then a small number of Polish people who also went to Shanghai. And it was a very small community of people who survived in that way. There are so many different survival stories, and that's one of them.
One more thing. My father, my mother, my brother and I were the only ones that survived the Holocaust. All the others were that in the cattle cars to Auschwitz and other concentration camps and were killed. Because part of 6 million people that were killed systematically by the German government. You can't imagine what 6 million people are. Just take the San Francisco Bay Area. A picture that everybody in this area is being shipped to a concentration camp and being gassed to death. There will be nothing left here.
Yes.
Did you experience a lot of discrimination against Jewish people while you were in Shanghai? Did you experience discrimination against Jewish people in Shanghai?
Not really. No. We were accepted as people like anybody else. The Japanese, they did it under pressure from the German government that they put us into those ghettos. But we lived right in the middle of the Chinese population. That's where I learned a little Chinese. And every day, the people I worked with at the dealership were all Chinese. I was invited to their homes. And I remember one time I was invited for dinner and lunch. And I went there and had a good lunch. And I had to be polite, so they filled me up with whiskey. It's the first time I experienced being a little drunk. They also tried to do something special for me by serving potato salad. And I tried the potato salad, and what it was sliced potatoes with peanut butter. And to be polite, I had to eat it. I spoke very broken English, and then I learned English and Chinese. I had a Chinese mechanic who was supposed to teach me, and he was just sitting there and he was pointing. and little by little I caught up with the words, and I could make myself understood. I could understand, but I forgot all of it because in Shanghai they spoke Ningpo dialect, and here they speak Nanking dialect, and so that was very difficult. But I knew enough to keep a conversation. Yes.
Do you still keep in contact with people from Shanghai, or do you not?
With whom?
Do you keep in contact with people from Shanghai?
No, there's nobody. So there was one, my shop foreman, he was in Shanghai to get away from the communists, and he went to Vancouver, Canada, and he got together quite a bit till he passed away.
Well, but the congregation who came to
Well, when we came here, we formed a congregation of Jews from Shanghai, which still exists in name. Most of the originals are not there anymore, but it's still a thriving congregation. And we try to keep up our tradition, but it slowly became Americanized, and now it's just another American congregation.
And you're just about the only ones left.
And we are about the only ones left. Yes.
because of age.
How old were you when you met your wife?
How old was I?
When you met your wife.
When I met my wife. She was 16, and I'm 5 years older than she is, so do the math.
Okay,
thank you. That's what I do all the time when I do my volunteer work at the San Francisco Critical Center.
Welcome to the bag. An old man on the streetcar, the thing that a poor old man has to work still. But he enjoys every minute of it. It's a great job.
We didn't hear the question.
Is he asked if I ever questioned being Jewish? Never. What? My religion. And no matter what, that's my religion. I believe in it. I sometimes question why. But I don't have an answer.
Did you ever experience discrimination here in the United States?
Not really.
We didn't hear the question.
Discrimination here in the United States.
Of course, you read in the paper about the neo-Nazis and the Ku Klux Klan and all that, those people, but I hope that the general public of the United States is not that people to be. To my volunteer work, I work next to an African-American, we are best friends. I worked next to Nicholas, who's from Greece. My boss is Japanese. My other boss is half Japanese. We have somebody in the office who is Mexican. So we are the United Nations. Caricature and that wasn't It was his. Yes?
Can you tell us how you got news when you were in Shanghai? How did you get news, for example, of what was happening back in Europe or in the Pacific? How did you find out about your family members back in China? Was that after the war, or was somebody
who got news? Well, while we were in Shanghai, we got friendly letters from our family trying to do something to get them to Shanghai, but by that time the British were charged in Shanghai. They refused to give permits to go there. And we heard rumors, and after the war we found out what really happened. And as a matter of fact, I think my father had got hold of some death certificates. The Germans were very particular in their dealing with everything. Everything was written down. And so we did find, or my father found some death certificates of our family that perished in Auschwitz or Terracing, one of these places. But during the war, no, we heard. We had British radio, we had German radio, we had French radio, we had Russian radio. And they all brought news the way they wanted us to hear it, but they never mentioned anything about that. I chose to come to the United States, but when I came here, it was not a first time. Oh. As a matter of fact, the people that supported us here in San Francisco, they said if you want to stay in San Francisco, you have to go to work. If you want to eat a dough the rest of your life, we send you to some other place. I hope you learned something today. I hope you take to heart that everybody's created equal. And there's no one better and no one worse. We are all human beings trying our best for our families, for our country, for the world.
Thank you to you too. It's a long time to sit, but thank you.
Shanghai, you know, spend the things that you rent on weekends to relax.
I How about one more round of applause?
I'm sorry. Thank you.